My special guest today is a Russell Smith Professor of International Relations at Pomona College in Claremont, California. His most recent book, Secessionism in African Politics, Aspiration, Grievance, Performance, and Disenchantment, was published by the Palgrave Macmillan Company, and a copy of it can be accessed on the link that I'm going to paste in the description panel on the upload for this video. Professor Engelbert, welcome.
Thanks for having me.
I'm happy to have you on this show today. You have done a phenomenal job as an academic, as a researcher, and I've had the opportunity to read many of your works on the Democratic Republic of Congo, on Mali, on Burkina Faso. If I can actually say the truth, my favorite is the one on unity, sovereignty, and sorrow.
It's my favorite too.
That's fantastic. Viewers and listeners, I'm going to paste all the publications of Professor Pierre Engelbert right in the description panel of this video. Prof, I understand that you are currently the director of Pomona College's African Politics Lab. Can you just briefly describe what this initiative is all about and the work that you do?
Yes, I'm the director, but it's not much of a lab. It's me and a couple of students. But still, we got funding about 5 years ago from the president and the dean at Pomona College, realizing that we didn't have sufficient focus on Africa in our teaching, in our research. And so this is kind of a project supported by the school to make it possible for African scholars to come and be visiting scholars on campus. We've had three so far, and we'll have five altogether before we go to the next phase of funding, hopefully. And then it also provides funding to recruit students to do research with me and to help with the programming, and it gives us funding to invite scholars to come and give talks. Now with COVID, things have been on hold, but otherwise we got about five or six Africanist and African scholars every semester to come and give talk. And then we have one scholar in residence from Africa during a whole semester teaching one class. Mm-hmm. And that's been part of what the African Politics Lab does. So it's a little bit short of a center, and it's kind of the name for this initiative, if you will. And it tries to have a multiplier effect beyond the classes that I teach to kind of create some sort of momentum on the study of Africa and generate interest among our students.
Now getting to the topic for discussion today, Africa's growth governance paradox. I understand that you did a research paper for Africa Plus with Gailin Portland, who was with Pomona College at the time of writing. Can you briefly describe, if I can say, the methodological structure of your research paper? Mm-hmm. What countries did you study and why? And if you can provide definitions for the terms that you use in the paper, that's laggards and developers.
Yeah, so it's a paper I did with Gailin. Richard Joseph from Northwestern University asked us for it. He's the one who hosts that blog, Africa Plus. And it's part of an ongoing research project. And I'm working with a different student on this governance issue. But essentially, here's the basic idea. Ever since about the 1990s, the World Bank and other donors have been pushing for improvements in African governance. And governance is really the way that the power is exercised in the management of an economy. And donors have, you know, were of the opinion that the lack of success of African development might be due in part, at least, to the fact that there's weakness in governance, for example, corruption, clientelism, red tape, rent-seeking, you know, all sorts of issues like that kind of undermine the effectiveness of policymaking and implementation. So then they push very hard for improvements in governance. And we try to find out, does it make a difference? Are the donors able to trigger change in governance? And do improvements in governance really facilitate growth? Now, the problem with that, Africa's had tremendous growth, as you know, over the last 10, 20 years. And in fact, you know, half of the fastest growing countries in the world have been in Africa. And so a lot of that growth is actually driven by commodity prices. So African countries tend to be resource rich. And because of demand in China and demands in other parts of the world, the price of commodities has gone up. As a result, essentially, what these countries are sitting on is valued at more, and therefore the GDP goes up, but it's not really representative of a transformation, if you will. So we try to exclude that, because if you try to find out, are there improvements in the economy due to better governance, you don't want the noise from the commodities boom to come in. So we excluded every country that had more than 10% of their GDP from exports of a primary commodity, whether it's a mineral or agricultural. And so we were left with the other countries. And of those, we did what we call a most different setup methodologically. So you try to separate the countries that behave the most differently in terms of the dependent variable, in this case, economic growth. And so we took of those countries with low primary commodities, we took the 10 fastest growing and we made one group with those, and the 10 slowest growing and we made one group with those. The first group we call the developer, the other group we call the laggards, right? And if you look at them, you can find that indeed, if you look at the growth over time, you have pretty much the laggards are flat. Despite the whole continent exploding economically, they are not moving. And those that have better governance show steady increase and really quite exponential, and not to the speed of the commodities one, but still impressive. So we said, okay, let's go back and look at the quality of governance. Mm-hmm. And we found that the developers had slightly better governance. So if you look at indicators of governance, you can find them from the World Bank, they call them CPIA, Country Policy Institutional Assessment. You can find them on Country Data, Political Risk Service, Mo Ibrahim. We looked at different sources. And so you find that, you know, there were indicators of good governance. You find that the developers are doing slightly better. Let's say on a scale of 0 to 10, the laggards are somewhere around 2 and the developers somewhere around 4. So they're still fairly weak altogether by universal standards, but it's better. However, what we don't see a very large gap, and we don't see sustained improvements for the developers. So we were wondering, you know, it suggests that policies that are aimed at improving governance do not really have an impact, that the countries are flatlining in terms of governance, but they're not all at the same level. And so that's one finding, that, you know, conditional policies to improve governance don't really have a strong effect on the ground. But small differences in governance might have a significant effect in growth. And we tried to understand why. And we looked at foreign direct investment. And we found that, sure enough, countries that have slightly better governance attract a lot more of foreign direct investment, even if they don't have commodities. Normally, it's the commodities that attract FDI. In this case, they still attract quite a bit. And so we suspect that even though governance is still not very good, that small improvement signals, is an economic signal to investors that the government is seriously committed to policies for growth, as opposed to thinking about patronage and things like that. And so there might be, you know, the change in the quality of governance is not enough to really generate the kind of internal growth that the World Bank and donors expect, but it might be enough to signal that you are not going to be expropriated, you are not going to be racketeered by government actors, etc. It's still a matter of hypothesis, and this project is ongoing, but that's by and large the summary of the story.
Is the economic growth of resource poor African countries linked to improvements in their economic governance? And what is the political reasoning behind?
Okay, it's a great question. So we do not see improvements in governance over time. Mm-hmm. We see variation. So we see the groups of countries, some countries have, you know, the developers have slightly better governance than the non-developers, but neither one of them shows change over time. It's very steady. It's remarkably steady. So when you think of the amount of money that the donors are pushing to improve all sorts of dimensions of governance, state capacity, bureaucratic quality, reducing corruption, that does not lead to any observable transformation. So we don't see change within countries over time, but we see change across countries, and these changes, or difference, we see difference across countries, and these differences are linked to difference in economic performance. And so the ones that have slightly better governance tend to attract more foreign direct investment that tend to go into industry and trigger a certain degree of transformation. And that's the crucial part, if you will, that, you know, back 20, 25 years ago, the bank came up with this notion that this was going to be Africa's century and that there was going to be a genuine transformation. But then the commodity boom essentially perversely took the wind out of those sails, because a lot of countries felt like they were doing very well without the need to industrialize and to dramatically change their economies, because the oil they had, the copper they had, the diamonds they had, the gold was much more valuable than it was a few years before. And so their economies were performing well. at very little cost in terms of short-term sacrifices. So I think in the long run, the commodity boom has been inimical to economic transformation in Africa. However, those resource-poor countries that have slightly better governance have seen a little bit more of industrialization. But this is really not a big trend altogether.
If African politics is based on neo-patrimonial logic of instrumentalization of the state and its resources for political benefit and sometimes to secure the loyalty of voters, how can it produce governance improvements without the rulers themselves reforming themselves out of power?
You know, that's a great question, and you put your finger exactly on the big issue. And that's where I think the donors have been somewhat helpless. And you know, as is very often the case with the World Bank and with other donors, there's a lack of genuine understanding of the political economy of African states, how they function. They tend to be really married to their microeconomic textbook, but they don't put them in a broader context of institutions and power and politics. Now, the neo-patrimonial argument has gotten a lot of pushback. You know, a lot of people find that it's problematic and that it kind of maybe even stigmatizes African politics to a degree. I still find a lot of use in it, right? So it's a basic notion that African states are these modern rational entities, but also function at a lower, at a different level, a slightly hidden level, function along lines of patrimonial politics in a Weberian sense, patronage, clientelism, redistribution of resources. So the state is both a tool for policy and the state is a resource to be appropriated and to be redistributed for consumption, if you will. And so neo-patrimonialism includes both dimensions. In some states, you know, like Botswana might be much more on the neo side, efficient state. Other countries like Congo might be a lot more on the patrimonial side, right? Now, what is important is that you have to step in the shoes of African elites and understand the conundrum they're dealing with. And so from the moment of independence, when they inherited the state, but all the way now when the state keeps reproducing over 60 plus years, there's a fundamental conundrum that the state, the tool they inherited from colonization, remains a largely disembedded structure from other societal factors. It doesn't mean that the state is completely arbitrary, artificial, and that Africans have not appropriated it, but it means that it lacks congruence with ways in which modes of production are organized within African societies, ways in which power is thought of, ways in which political legitimacy is produced. So then the rulers inherit structures that are really sitting on very tenuous ground, and every day they have to kind of restart the social contract. They have to kind of re-engineer the allegiance or the compliance, at least the acquiescence of their societies to the state. And so then using the state as a resource, bring people in around the state, through the distribution of rents, through certain policies, subsidies, through employment in the public service. All these things make a lot of political sense because you can't just develop if people challenge their, you know, we just did this book on secessionism. If people challenge their very participation in the state, it's a nightmare to get anything done. So to limit the potential for defection and free riding, African elites have a higher propensity and a greater return from deploying the state as a resource. And that's why we speak of neo-patrimonialism when, you know, people say, oh, it's corruption. Yeah, you can call it corruption, but it's also rational politics to keep the place together, which is kind of a first step, if you will. So I have a certain degree of sympathy for these policies, but the truth of the fact is that these policies are non-developmental. If you use the state as a resource and you focus on distribution, on corruption, on rent seeking, then essentially you reduce the efficiency of your economy. You send wrong signals to producers, investors, and you make it a steeper hill for you to climb in terms of development. But development might not be the only game in town. And in the short run, every government might say we want development, but first of all, we want to stay in power. And first of all, we want the state not to fall apart. And so this is not a moot point. I mean, you look at Sudan, you look at Nigeria, you look at Congo, they've all had to deal with significant crisis, territorial crisis, crisis of existential dimensions, you know? So I understand this use of resources, but it leads to what we would call bad governance from like a World Bank perspective, but it's also good governance in terms of good politics, if you will. But there's a trade-off. It comes at the cost of development to a certain degree.
Viewers and listeners, this was Professor Engelbert. He is a Russell Smith Professor of International Relations at Pomona College in Claremont, California. Many of his works can be accessed on the links that I'm going to paste right in the description panel on the upload for this video. Professor Engelbert, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you so much for having me. It was my pleasure.
Wonderful.